The problem, what is the second opinion? Second opinion arises like, audit firm is going to make the audit of audit client. Okay? On one issue, they got a dispute.
Mm-hmm.
Audit manager told, sir, please change these adjustments. Otherwise, we are going to give you a qualified opinion. Audit client said, no, this is allowable. Okay? They said, no, we will not do it. They said, we will give our audit opinion as a qualified opinion. Then audit client is not happy with your firm. They said, okay, we will go for a second audit opinion. They called to the other audit firm. They discussed their issue and they said,
yeah,
what's your opinion? They said, we will give you unqualified opinion, unmodified opinion. This is called second opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Then if the other audit firm is going to give a different opinion, then it is going to put a pressure on you.
Mm-hmm.
Your existing auditor, you are going to put a pressure. Your client will say, that audit firm is going to give us an unmodified opinion. You are going to give us a qualified opinion. Okay? So in such a condition, you have to be very careful. Now, just read it. Another way that auditor can suffer an intimidation threat is that when the audit client is unhappy with the proposed audit opinion and seeks a second opinion from a different firm of auditor.
Mm-hmm.
In such a situation, the second audit firm will not be able to give a formal audit opinion on the financial statements. So this is restricted. A second audit firm will not give a formal audit opinion. Okay, they cannot say, okay, come to us and we will give you our modified report, pay us our this fee and we will give you audit opinion. No, they cannot. This is a restriction. Yeah. Second thing, only an appointed auditor can do that. However, the problem is that if a different firm of auditor indicates to someone else audit client that a different audit opinion might be acceptable. Okay, the appointed auditor may feel under pressure to change the audit opinion. In effect, self-interest threat arises.
Mm-hmm.
Like, second opinion, change the opinion, otherwise you are going to lose that client. Okay, so self-interest threat arises as the existing auditor may feel that they will lose the next year audit if they does not change their this year opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there is nothing to stop a company director taking to a second firm of auditor about treatments of matters in the means. You cannot stop your client. He can ask any audit firm, okay? Good. But that proposed next auditor, what they have to do, what they will do, even they have listed all the circumstances, they cannot issue a formal audit opinion. First, this audit will be finished. They have to be removed from their auditor list. The new auditor should be appointed, okay? Then he will be a acting auditor, okay? Like that. Next. However, a firm being asked for a second opinion should be very careful.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's coming for the second audit firm.
Mm-hmm.
They have to be very careful.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that audit client is not going to explain them the matter in such a way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
As existing auditor knows. They know the technicalities of that issue. They know what is happening on the ground. Okay? And that director called that audit firm, oh, this is a small issue, our auditor is going to give us a qualified opinion. We have discussed this with them. He is not willing to change his opinion. So can you give us a qualified, unmodified opinion? So they have to listen to that thing. They have to be very careful. They cannot say, we will give you audit opinion. Because they have to, otherwise they will be found themselves in a litigation. Next. Director has not given them a full information, okay? Then that proposed auditor should have been given a permission to communicate with existing auditor and to discuss with him all the facts.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now second, between yeah,
the
yeah, now the communication is coming between the auditor.
Mm-hmm.
If the permission is not given, the auditor should decline to comment on the audit opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so second opinions are going to affect some independence issues also for auditor. Is it okay now?
So what will be the safeguard in such a manner?
See, in such a manner, safeguards are like this, that first thing is this, that second firm cannot give the opinion. Okay? If even they are willing to give an opinion, first they have to discuss that matter with your audit firm. Okay? And they have to discuss all the things. Okay, and then even after discussing a matter with your firm, they cannot be a formal auditor. First, you should have to withdraw from engagement. you have to be removed from your that audit engagement, and then he should be a auditor, like to appoint a casual vacancy.
Okay,
then casual, you will have to withdraw from engagement. Okay, you cannot accept his opinion as part of your opinion. So second opinion is not acceptable. There is a no safeguard that is going to reduce this effect. Okay, either to continue the engagement or to withdraw from engagement. Okay, we are coming to the chapter 3, that is called legal liability. Professional accountant may have a professional liability under statutory law. Okay. Okay. We are coming for professional liability. It's okay. See, we are coming for professional liability, chapter 3. What is professional liability? In this chapter, we will see legal liability, what is that? What is negligence? What is restricting liabilities? What is current issues in auditor liability? What is fraud and error? And what is expectation gap? You know, there is a contract between audit firm and their audit client. Okay, because in every contract the obligation has to be performed. Okay, because in every contract there is some product is there, there is some service is there, for that there is some price is there. In audit, the contract is between audit firm and audit client. Now in that assignment of audit, auditors has to be very careful, because this auditing profession is being regulated more strictly. They cannot be a negligent in their work. But if in somehow they are unable to possess reasonable skills, then their client can sue them. Yes. Okay. If the contract is breached, the aggrieved party has a right to sue the offender party. Okay, now under law, insolvency legislation, the auditors are considered as a officer of the company, and they will be found guilty under criminal offenses. Like in Enron case, they were found criminally guilty. Okay, because they are having certain confidential information. Beyond that, auditors can be found to the market abuse offenses, such as insider dealing. What is insider dealing? Where they are having a critical
information.
Yeah, they are sharing that information. Second, they could be liable for failing in disclosure of obligatory disclosures, money laundering, treason, trafficking, drug trafficking, and act of terrorist. Okay, now auditors have a professional liability in the tort of negligence. If auditors are unable to perform their work as per requirement of competence, they will be found negligent. Or agar auditor negligent honge to wo apna kaam nahi proper kar sake, to they will be found a guilty for that thing. Okay, so in negligence, but being a negligent, first we have to see what is the negligent. Negligence is a common law concept. In F4 you might have studied common law. In that common law, the aggrieved party has to be reimbursed for their loss in money terms. Okay, if due to the failure of in performing the contract, the other party has faced certain loss, it has to be reimbursed with money. Remedies are only monetary. Okay, so to prove our action of negligence, there are three things. Duty of care. Does duty of care exist between them? First thing. Then they have to prove it, that duty of care was breached. Third, due to that duty of care breach, the other party has suffered a loss. Then their claim will be a successful. Okay. Then second, who might bring an act for negligence? कौन नेग्लिजेंस जो है वो एक्शन ले सकता है. फर्स्ट द कंपनी, कंपनी ले सकती है, कंपनी कैन टेक इट, शेयर होल्डर्स कैन टेक इट एज एक्शन फॉर नेग्लिजेंस अगेंस्ट ऑडिटर, बैंक कैन ऑल्सो डू इट, अदर लैंडर्स कैन ऑल्सो डू इट एंड अदर इंटरेस्टेड थर्ड पार्टीज. ओके, सो दीज आर द पोटेंशियल लाइक पीपल हु कैन सू ऑन द नेग्लिजेंस टू द ऑडिटर. बट टू लाइक एंड दे वॉन्ट टू बी सक्सेसफुल इन देयर दिस नेग्लिजेंस क्लेम, दे हैज टू प्रूव सर्टेन थिंग्स. फर्स्ट देयर वॉज द एक्सटेंट ऑफ प्रॉक्सिमिटी. प्रॉक्सिमिटी कहते हैं क्लोजनेस, दिस इज कॉल्ड क्लोजनेस, फर्स्ट थिंग. सेकेंड देयर वॉज अ सफिशियंट रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन द ऑडिटर एंड दैट अदर पार्टी एंड देयर वॉज अ ड्यूटी ऑफ केयर. ओके, सो दीज थ्री एरिया, ड्यूटी ऑफ केयर, ड्यूटी ऑफ केयर वॉज ब्रीच्ड एंड लॉस अकर्ड. सो दिस इज द बेसिक कंसेप्ट इन प्रोफेशनल लाइबिलिटी. If you are going to see any scenario, you will apply these thumb of rule. ठीक है, आपने इसको follow करना है कि duty of care थी, duty of care breach हो गई है और breach होने की वजह से आपको loss भी हुआ है. Okay, here you can see the audit client. Company is there, shareholders are there, but here you can see shareholders as a body. Okay. Company is equal to shareholders as a body, not individual shareholders. If in a company there are more than 1,000 shareholders, the auditor is not liable to all of them separately, individually. Okay, I am your shareholder, you are my auditor. Okay, I am your shareholder, why you are enjoying party with the management? I am your shareholder, your independence is affected. No, it's not like that. Getting my point? Okay, so company means shareholders acting as a body. It's not like shareholder plus shareholder plus shareholder plus shareholder. Okay, now the company has a contract with the auditor. Okay, not shareholders are having contract with the auditor. Shareholders are working as a body. They are the members. Okay. And the auditor is appointed as the auditor of that company. He is not the auditor of that shareholder. Okay, now it's clear. Next, as per laws and regulations of almost all countries, the auditing profession has been scrutinized and it has to follow certain more strict like rules and regulations. Okay, duty of care is implied. Okay, they have to follow duty of care. So for a client, for an audit client, duty of care exists? Yes, it's automatic. It means company can anytime sue audit firm. Getting my point? The company, their shareholders as a body, they can sue their audit firm, their auditor, because duty of care is automatically proved in audit. Breach, yes, they have to prove that their duty of care has been breached. If they have proved this thing, after that they have to prove that due to this breach they also suffered a loss. It means all of these should be yes, 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 yes. इन तीनों का अगर yes होगा तो ठीक है, duty of care exist करती है, जी करती है, बिल्कुल automatic है ये तो audit में. Breach हुई है, अगर answer yes में आता है तो ठीक है. If answer is in yes, then third step. Loss arise, yes हुआ है, और अगर हुआ है तो उसकी वजह से आपके खिलाफ जो है वो sue successful हो जाएगा. Okay? It's clear. Now, the auditor's duty of care. What is the auditor duty of care? There are certain practical scenarios are there, cases are there. We will discuss them here. Okay? We will see that. Okay. The standard of work of auditors is generally as defined by legislation. Okay? Whatever auditor has to work, what standards they has to follow, what should be the quality of work, how they perform, First, they have to maintain independence as per code of ethics, that is duty of care. That quality they have to maintain. Then they have to follow different auditing standards. Okay? It's mandatory for them. So that is ERC. Usko follow karna duty of care mein. Theek hai? Now there are below certain cases are there. In that we will see how the auditors are having a duty of care. This is a case, Ree Kingston Cotton Mill, 1896. It is very old case. So ये case है जी Ree Kingston का 1896 में आया था, बहुत पुराना case है. Let us see this case. When Loeb's LJ considered the degree of skill and care required of an auditor, he declared. ये जनाब एक person थे Loeb's LJ. This was a person Loeb's LJ. Okay. He considered that what is the skills and care that is required from an auditor. He said, it is the duty of an auditor to bring to bear on the work he has to perform that skill, care and caution what a reasonably competent, careful and cautious auditor would use. It means you are auditor. You are going for the audit of company. I am also auditor. They will check that are you doing your work with duty and duty of care. That duty of care which I am expected to follow, you are also expected to follow. It means there is a no fixed amount. Okay? They will what they will say, in one scenario they will tell you to come and audit. You will audit it. Then they will call me, come and audit. I will also make audit it. Then third auditor will come. Reasonably competent auditor. Okay? The difference should be almost same, minimal difference should be there. If the gap is more, then you are found guilty by the breach of duty of care. Okay? Second, and this duty of care, a reasonable skill and care, this depends upon a particular circumstances. It is different. It is not having a fixed amount. Yet fixed nahi hai. Ye har scenario ke hisab se change ho jayegi. Theek hai? Are you understanding me? Okay. Okay, Loeb's was careful to point out that what constitutes reasonable care depends very much on the facts of a particular case. So you have to see every case, particular case by case. Okay, next, another criteria by which the courts will determine the adequacy of auditor work is by assessing it in a relation to generally accepted accounting standards of that day. It means your work will be evaluated by checking that auditing standards. Did you follow that standards? Did you follow professional skepticism? Okay. What your evidence standard says, that which kind of evidence you can take. What is the high quality evidence? Third party document. Getting my point? Like that, you have to follow certain auditing standards. Agar client ne aapko sue kar diya, aapne proof karna hai ki aapne kaam auditing standard ke hisab se kiya. Agar aapne proof kar diya to koi masla nahi hai. If your client has sued you, okay, then you have to proof that you have followed all ISA. Working papers are there and you have maintained all duty of care, then you are not negligent. So they have to prove that your duty of care was breached. So now duty of care is not breached. Even duty of care is breached, the client has saved himself from law, then also you are not allowed to pay anything.
What if there was no proximity? What if there was no proximity when this happened?
See, proximity means, we will further discuss it, proximity also. Okay, coming, coming. I don't want to discuss it early. Let me to finish the thing. Okay? Okay, there was a case in 1967. The code will be very much considered with accepted advanced auditing techniques demonstrated by Pennyquick J. In name you should forget, which he observed. The real ground on which Ree Kingston Cotton Mill, I think, capable of being distinguished is that standard of reasonable care and skill upon the expert evidence more exacting today than those prevailed in 1896. What happened? In this case, they said what a reasonable and normal auditor should have to maintain the skills. Now here they are going to say that 1896 is old case. Okay? That is old case. At that time, the expertise skills required was different. Nowadays in 1967, after 70 years, okay, now the case has been changed. Now the auditor has to change. with the changing requirement of the day. Okay, the Ortec techniques which was followed in 90s, now they are useless. You have to go for new techniques. As environment is going to change, so you also have to change. Okay. जी इधर ये था कि जो 1896 में जो ऑर्टिंग की टेक्निक्स थी वो पुरानी हो चुकी हैं. नए केस में जनाब आर ई थॉमस जैरन एंड सन लिमिटेड के केस में ऑडिट जज ने कहा था कि आपको ये टेक्निक्स जो है वो अपडेट करनी पड़ेगी. लेट अस सी अनदर केस स्टडी इज देयर. नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू अंडरस्टैंड दैट व्हाट इज ड्यूटी ऑफ केयर. ओके, हाउ इट कुड अफेक्ट यू व्हेन यू आर हैविंग अ डीलिंग विद योर ऑडिट क्लाइंट. सो यू हैव टू चेक इट. ओके, they must come to it with an inquiring mind. They said auditor should come with an inquiring mind, professional skepticism. आपने inquiry mind रखना है, but not suspicion of dishonesty. ये नहीं सोचना कि management सारी corrupt है. Don't think that management is corrupt. Okay, they are not dishonest, but suspecting that someone may have made a mistake somewhere. Okay, unintentional mistake. You have to check that mistakes, okay? Somewhere, and that check must be made to ensure that there has been none mistakes. Okay?
So what should we actually learn from these case studies?
Yeah, these case studies, you are going to learn that your audit client, who can sue you? Who can sue you?
Shareholder.
Bank, shareholder. Shareholder can sue you. Existing shareholder can sue you. Okay, like you have issued an audit report, your existing shareholder has purchased a share on the basis of that audit report, he increased his shareholding, they have found that the financial statements duty of care was not followed, can he sue you? Okay, so this case is coming that who can sue you? Aapko kaun sue kar sakta hai? Shareholder kar sakte hai, company kar sakti hai, ya bank? Bank can sue you or bank cannot sue you? Okay, so we will see there are little minor differences are there. Yes, minor differences are there. In one case bank cannot sue you. Ek case mein bank aapko sue nahi kar sakega, but only with minor difference bank will sue you and they will be successful, because they have to prove. Is there duty of care?
Automatic.
With company only. They have to prove it with bank. Bank has to prove duty of care exists. If yes, then they have to prove this has been breached. Then they have to prove that they have suffered a loss. Okay?
Sir, if the company has to make into a loan approval document. They are actually giving it to the auditor. Say that there are no problem, there is a big problem. So that this is actually being given to the bank for them to have a new facility or a new loan. So in such a case, and in case there is some fault on the part of the auditor, who does the bank sue?
Yes, we will see it. Wait. Okay, third party's context. Third party bank is normally, we will see it, third party can sue you or not. In a case of third parties, duty of care exists, they has to prove it. Okay, then duty of care breached must be proved, loss arising must be proved. Okay, so in your question is also very good, but you have to read this thing. Okay, I am going to answer your question also. In 1984, okay, there was one company, that's name was Caparo Industries. Okay, that purchased 100,000 Fidelity shares in the open market. Fidelity was another company. Okay, Caparo purchased 100,000 Fidelity shares. Okay, on 12th June, the date on which the financial statement audited by Touch Rose were published. अब कैपारो ने 1,00,000 शेयर ले लिए फिडेलिटी के, एंड दिस टच रोज इज द ऑडिटर ऑफ फिडेलिटी. ओके, नॉट कैपारो. गेटिंग माय पॉइंट? देन they purchased, okay, were published, after financial statements are published, they purchased further 50,000 shares. Okay, when they saw the financial statement altered by the auditor, who saw Keparo, then they decided to purchase more 50,000 shares. Relying on the information in financial statements, further shares were acquired. On 4 September, Keparo made a bid for the remainder and by October had acquired control of Fidelity. Okay. Okay, next. This is Keparo. This is Fidelity. Touch Rose. This is auditor. Okay. This is auditor. This is audit client. This is third party. Okay. First, they purchased 100,000 shares on 12th June. Okay. Then, after issuing, okay. No. They purchased earlier, okay. On 12th June, 50,000 shares they purchased. Okay. Then, after checking the financial statements that were audited by the Touch Rose. Okay. Now, they made a bid in September. Okay, they made a bid for acquisition, and then in October they got control. Like 1st October they got control of Fidelity. Why they were, how they got a, they saw the 1.3 million profit and loss. They saw 1.3 million as profit. Okay, because when they saw 1.3 million pound profit in that company's profit and loss, that financial statement was audited by the auditor, then they go for a bid. But instead of this thing, when they check the accounts, the company was not in profit, the company was in loss. 0. This was actual. 0.4 million was actual loss. Now, this Keparo sued auditor. They said, we trusted on your audit report. Okay. We acquired this company, instead of 1.3 million, there is a loss of 0.4 million. So we have suffered a loss of 1.7 million, something like that. Okay? So you have to pay us this amount. The case went in court, House of Lord. Okay? In that case, the conclusion of House of Lord, so in that case, the Keparo has to prove first, duty of care, then there was a breach, and due to breach there was a loss. Loss was there, yes. Does duty of care breach?
It is not even there in the first place.
First, duty of care was there? No. There was no duty of care, and then there is a no reason for breach or not. How? In this case answer, the House of Lords said that auditors are going to be a liable, or duty of care is only to the
audit
existing shareholders as a company, shareholders as a body, company. They have a no duty to you. Okay, if you have relied on those audited financial statements, okay, that's your mistake. But they don't have a direct duty of care with you.
So even in that bank situation, you don't need the bank parts from the audit.
If the bank is going to rely on the audit report, solely on the audit report, there is a no duty of care. Auditor is not responsible.
What if the bank had contacted the auditor?
Yes. Now they have to prove it. They contacted the auditor. They said, we are going to give him a loan. Mm-hmm. Auditor will say, "Acha, you are going to give him a loan? Mm-hmm. Okay. We will give you this service, we will charge this fee."
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Then they will come and then they will make, then the client will get approval. Bank will ask the client, give the permission to your auditor. They are coming for one assignment.
Then there is a duty of care.
Then there is the duty of care.
But only through the phone stuff, if it is there, even if verbal is also allowed.
See, verbal is there. Verbal is not a, like what you say, it's not a, it's not a, what you say, trusted document.
Mm-hmm.
On words, who believe?
Mm-hmm.
But if word is there, what it has given word, he is responsible. Okay.
So that's why I'm asking, if it is only through word of mouth.
Yeah, it's possible. Yes, it's responsible.
It's still responsible.
Yes, 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 yes. I will show you one thing. One scenario
but
is
he
there.
Has to prove that I actually told what in the auditor.
I will tell you. I will tell you. There was an annual general meeting one day. Auditor was standing there. Everyone, all shareholders were there. Banks were also there. Okay. One of the bank managers came to the auditor. Hello, sir. How are you? The auditor is here. Sir, I'm from bank. Sir, this company is having good prospects. Yeah. Sir, we are going to give them a loan on the base of your audit report. So, what do you suggest? Should we trust that your audit report for this purpose? If the auditor is going to say yes, then audit firm is liable. If you will say, okay, wait, come to us. Okay, we will give you this advice services, this is my card, come to my office, we will give you this audit services, we will charge, this will be our fee, we will discuss this issue there. Okay, so auditor is not going to give him a straightforward answer. It means, if he is going to say yes, then auditor is liable. If he is going to say no, then auditor is not liable.
Okay, but then, Later,
when
in
case of
a
problem, the
whole thing is taken into court.
Mm.
And when it's always verbal,
there can
always be conflicts.
So
how, and you
who
said,
has to prove it? The bank. That duty of care is breached.
Yeah.
They have to prove it. They have to prove it that duty of care exists.
Yeah,
that
but what if conflict is only verbal and the order is denied it?
That's okay. Then the judge will decide on court that who is telling a lie. And I am not a judge. Second thing, when such kind, if on that time a media person was making a video and auditor don't know and they got a video.
Yeah, video, yeah.
Then, getting my point? So, this has to be proved in a court and the court will make a decision on this thing that who is guilty and who is not guilty. In Caparo case, there was a no duty of care. Okay, and auditor they quote this case, we are not having duty of care with banks or something, but in practical scenarios, banks are going to give rating to the audit firms.
Mm.
Okay.
Banks give the rating?
To the audit firms.
Okay.
For loan purpose. If you need a loan, from this bank, get it to be audited your financial statement from that audit firm. Okay. Then they will talk with that audit firm. Sir, we are going to give them a loan. We received your audited financial statements. Should we trust it? Give us advice. Getting my point? So banks are also very smart. After this case, they went more smart. They said, no, we will not accept this. Next scenario. In James and McNaughton Paper Group Limited versus Hickson, Anderson and Co. 1990. Here what happened? Same case was there, but Lord Justice Neil set out the following position in the light of Caparo and earlier cases. In England, restrictive approach was now adopted to any extension of the scope of the duty of care beyond the person directly intended by the maker to the statement to act upon it. This is the same. One person want to use it, bank want to use it. Now the auditor is going to give him a direct communication is between bank and audit firm. Yes,
sir. We have a class.
1:30.
Because the
care only
is over.
I know, sir. 1:30.
Yeah?
1:30. 20 minutes.
No, look, if it is over, then you
have to give up. I need it. Just 20 minutes.
Just finish over there.
Yeah, yeah.
Wo aave uske paas khali ye system hai.
Okay. You need this classroom. Can we sit other classroom?
No. You have to teach,
sir? Yeah, I have to teach. So, instead of using projector,
who will use it? You are only teaching her. You are also teaching her.
Oh.
There was no student there.
No, I'm not teaching.
It's only he only does.
They need this room.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay. Tell him your name. Here we have a good student.
I put that person to work on the recruit. It must have.
Help me. Come here. So you can come there. Okay, now you have to open your book, okay? Now the judge has changed his decision. They said in England a restrictive approach was now adopted by the extension of the scope of duty of care beyond the person directly intended by the maker or the statement to act upon it. In deciding whether a duty of care exists in a particular case, it was necessary to take all the circumstances into account. Now it's not like that only the person who is having a direct communication, he is having a duty of care. Okay? Now they are going for more strict approach. They have to see the all scenario. Okay. However, it was possible to identify certain matters which are likely to be of importance in most cases in reason to decision whether or not a duty of care exists. Here in below, there is one more case study. Just read this case study. You know, in this case, there was one Britannia Security Group, okay, whose financial statements were audited, okay, and that company was acquired by
ADT
for 105 million, but later found to be worth of only 40 million, okay. Although under Caparo case, auditor do not owe a duty of care in general to third parties. The judge found that BBH audit partner Martin Bishop, who confirmed that the firm stood by BSD financial statement at a meeting with ADT in the run-up to the acquisition. Now here what happened? Here this thing happened that in ADT case, the judge found that audit firm, that audit partner stood with that acquisition. That ADT contacted that audit firm. They asked their auditor. His auditor is going to say, yes, I stood by my this audit report or financial statement, then auditor is responsible. ठीक है, इधर जो है वो ADT ने कंपनी तो acquire कर ली BSG, ओके, लेकिन बाद में उसके हिसाब से 40 मिलियन हुए. अब केपारो केस के तहत ऑडिटर बचने की कोशिश कर रहा था, लेकिन जज ने देखा कि जो ADT था उसने ना ऑडिटर से डायरेक्ट कम्युनिकेशन की थी, और जो ऑडिट पार्टनर था मार्टिन बिशप उसने इस चीज को एक्सेप्ट किया था. सो नाउ देयर वाज अ कॉन्ट्रैक्चुअल रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन ऑडिटर एंड दैट ADT कंपनी. ओके, नाउ व्हाट हैपेंड आफ्टर दैट, द केस वेंट अगेंस्ट द ऑडिटर. ओके, so now this development occurred apparently because post Keparo solicitor and bankers were advising clients intent on acquisition to get direct assurance from target auditor on the truth and fairness of financial statements. After this what happened after Keparo case, the banks were directly talking with the auditors. They said no, we will directly talk with the auditor and we will take their consent also. If they will give us a consent that we stand by this audit report, then it's okay, we will issue you a loan, otherwise we will not issue you a loan. Okay, like that way ADT also followed same method. Okay, now what happened, BBH applied appealed this decision, this audit firm has appealed this decision. Okay, the liable partner, because of a shortfall in insurance cover which left facing the prospect of coming up with £34 million, and out of court settlement was reached with ADT. They said we are unable to pay them their loss. Even our all audit firm's assets are up to 34 million.
Not enough.
So court has told them to go out of court and give make your final settlement. Okay. Okay. In next case, same case is there. You have to read this case. Okay. The main theme is same. Okay. Duty of care exists? Yes. Duty of care does not exist? No. So when there is a direct indirect engagement, direct engagement is there when auditor is client is directly asking to the auditor. Okay, in this case, let's suppose in one company, okay, company A. This is company A. Okay, and this is auditor. Okay, auditor has issued audit report. On financial statements. Okay, now in that audit report, one of the shareholder, okay, there was one shareholder was there, he trusted at that report. Okay, one shareholder was there
of company A.
Yeah, existing shareholder. Okay, he trusted at that audit report and he went to acquire for the share. Further, then it was discovered that this audit report was not with due care, okay, something like that. And this all shareholder, not okay, us. Sued that auditor. Can he sue it?
Yeah.
Huh? He can?
He can.
Individual shareholder. No. Shareholder, he cannot sue it.
My individual shareholder can't do it?
Cannot.
Even if it's having 51% shareholding?
Yeah. He cannot sue it. Individual shareholder cannot sue it. They can sue it as a acting as a body. For your example, you said that 51%, right? It means they are having a control. Okay? So they can sue a file, not as a pay, what you say? One is called claimant, another is they cannot sue as a claimant as an individual shareholder. They will sue as a company. Okay? So this existing shareholder cannot sue. But they will pass a resolution as a company, shareholders come acting as a body, and this company will sue the auditor. Even on back side, that 51% shareholder is there.
But if the expectation is gap, no? It's like it's actually as if the auditor is only accountable to the shareholders, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's not accountable.
But
to the
shareholder
company.
Acting as a body.
Mm-hmm.
Acting as a body. Mm-hmm. Okay, not like 51% scenario is different. The thing is that if one person is having 2% share on the base of this audit report, he acquired more shares. So auditor is not responsible to him. Auditor is going to give a report, shareholders acting as a body. If he wants to acquire share, he needs direct communication with the auditor. He should have to talk with the auditor. Direct communication.
So basically for institutional investors.
Yes. There should be a direct. Direct communication should be there. So you got the idea? Okay? Because the contract is not with one shareholder. Auditor is not auditor of that shareholder. Auditor is the auditor of that client. Client is that company. And company and shareholders are separate. Okay? Getting my point? Separate personalities. So you, further you can see there's banks and other major lenders are there, same assurance services. Okay. Now we are coming to the disclaimers. What is disclaimer? When you hear some scheme, even on radio or on television, okay?
Just to note, to highlight certain areas.
Yeah, you are getting like, invest 1 rupee and get millions of profits, or like the BS shareholder. Then there's a small, terms and conditions of life, okay? The investment in mutual funds is very risk provider, very risky area, so terms and conditions of life, so please protect your brokers. In such a fast way, getting one word? Like that, invest in, this mutual fund, you will get interest, credit appreciation, what you say, capital worth, you will get this benefit, retirement benefit, something like that, when you will get told. When in the end, top of the pressure applies, talk to your broker, these investments are highly risky, you can lose your money. Like that. These are called disclaimers. Even you can see on the parking areas, receipt is there. What they say? This is only for the parking of vehicle. We are not responsible for any loss. Okay? If something gets hit to the vehicle, you cannot sue that parking of that owner of the parking. You can sue that other person. Okay? So, like that, disclaimers are also there. Okay? Disclaimer is normally an attempt to limit the liability to client. But can you see this audit report? Auditor is having a trust. Public is having a trust on audit report. Banks are having a trust. When in their audit report, in the end, okay, we have reviewed financial statements are true and fair. We have checked each and everything. We got evidence. Okay, internal controls are effective. In the end, if you will see one writing this disclaimer, we are not going to be responsible. We are not going to be responsible. This is for this purpose. You are not responsible. So, can you just think that this kind of disclaimers will affect that credibility of audit report?
So, what do you say? It's actually, in the disclaimer, do you actually write this only, we are only accountable to the shareholders?
That depends, you can write it.
Okay. So if such a thing, and the same scenario is taken, the shareholder depending on the auditor report and then getting suing the auditor. In the court, the court asks, like, is the duty of care owed? I am a shareholder. And is he is accountable to a shareholder?
Shareholder acting as a body.
Shareholder acting as a body.
Body.
He will say,
these are the things, these are the loopholes, this is called expectation gap.
Okay, how many of them constitute as a body?
Company, controlling.
So only the company itself can, the board of directors can sue the auditor?
No. They will pass a resolution. In that resolution, they will discuss this matter with the shareholders. They will get their consent. They will pass a resolution, and with that resolution, they will file a case against the auditor.
From the company as well.
Yes, from the company as well. Okay. So in this paragraph, in the last two lines, standard disclaimers are not an appropriate or proportionate response to the Bannerman decision. Their incorporation as a standard feature of the audit report could have the effect of devaluing audit report. Even ACCA says that audit report, if you are going to include any kind of such disclaimers, so it means you are going to undermine that value or credibility of that audit report. But disclosures are there. Okay, then how you can limit your risk of that being sued? In your next paragraph, you can see it. Litigation avoidance. How you can avoid your litigations? The other aspect of how firms are trying to deal with litigation is what they are trying to do, avoid litigations. Like client acceptance procedure. First, when you are going to accept a client, you have to see its background. If its normal practice is after every audit, they are going to sue the auditor. So don't accept it. Okay? You have to see their client integrity or something like that. Okay? Then we will see these client acceptance procedures are what are those. We will further consider in our chapter 5. Performance of audit work. Make sure that you are going to conduct your audit in the best practice of ISO. Okay? If you are following international standard of auditing with full theme, okay, then it's good. There's no worry. If they are going to sue you, you should not be worried because your work is as per your standard. Third, quality control. This includes not just control over individual audits but also stricter whole firm procedures. You have to maintain quality control, ISQC1. We are going to check quality control, pre-issuance quality control, post-issuance quality control, so that your quality should not get down. If your quality is getting down, there is a risk that client will sue you.
So after every audit, they call the quality control officer?
Yes, in every audit. In every audit. Firms are having a quality control procedure. ISQCs, we will further study it.
Is that where the quality control comes, where the code review happens?
Yes.
It's a part of the code review. Yeah. Code review is a part of the quality control
procedure. Yes, of course.
The one who does the code review, is it the same as the quality control officer?
Of course, same.
Same person.
Same. Okay. Then issuance of appropriate disclosures. Okay. So you can issue appropriate disclaimers also, like that this audit report is only for the use of shareholders acting as a body. Okay. If you need any advice, you can contact us. Okay. You should say that we don't accept any responsibility. You can say for further investments in that company, okay, please feel free to contact us. Getting one word? Such kind of wording you can use as in the disclaimer.
Sorry, no.
Get a...
No,
1:30. Okay, 2 minutes are there.
No, 1:30.
Okay, bacha. Okay, we are going to finish it. So, in our next topic, we will study restricting liability. Okay, and then advantages and disadvantages. Limited liability partnerships, we will study it. Okay. Grant issues we will study it, then we will study fraud. Because today it was very easy for me to finish this chapter. Instead of finishing this chapter, we have to evaluate our previous tests that we have conducted. So second ethics test is coming on. Okay, small test will be there. You have to write for this thing. Okay.
The question, sir.
Pardon.